this is Sheila Bender, and you are listening to In Conversation, Discussions on Writing and the Writing Life. Today we have with us in the studio Seattle poet Ed Harkness. He lives in Shoreline and is the author of 3 full-length poetry collections from Pleasure Boat Press, Saying the Necessary, Beautiful Passing Lives, and most recently, The Law of the Unforeseen. Ice Children, a chapbook of 18 poems, was published by Split Lip Press in 2014. His poetry has appeared in online journals Two River, Atticus Review, Cascadia Review, The Good Men Project, Inchas de Poesia, The Humanist, Rat's Ass Journal, Raven Chronicles, Salt River Review, Split Lip Magazine, Switched on Gutenberg, and Terrain.org. And it is, of course, in print journals, including most recently Cheriton Review and Miramar. Welcome to the program, Ed.
Thank you very much.
It's great to see you. We taught together a long time ago now in Shoreline Community College. Mm-hmm. It's great to have you here. Thank you for making the trek.
It's my pleasure.
I'm very excited about hearing you talk about the things you're writing now, but also how you came to poetry. You've had a long career in it.
Sure. I started in high school. I had a great English teacher, Jerry Wells. One of the things he did in English class, my sophomore English class, was to actually read poems aloud. And that was just enormous for me. I'd always been a kind of plodding reader, and hearing poems just made a huge difference for me. And so I began to think more about poetry, and by my senior year in high school, I tried to write a couple of poems. After that, I went to the University of Washington.
I did, in the 80s.
And did you take classes from Nelson Bentley?
I certainly did.
Well, so did I. And David Wagner and some visiting poets who came to the campus that you might remember, Mark Strand being one. But then the big turning point for me in my poetry arc was taking classes from Madeline DeFries. Mm-hmm. She was Sister Madeline. She was still a nun at that time. This would have been in 1970. I took a class from her, and I think it was the following summer I took a class from Richard Hugo. Now, both DeFries and Hugo taught at the University of Montana. They ran the vaunted graduate writing program at the University of Montana. I applied with Madeline's encouragement and got in. The rest is history, you might say.
Well, the rest is a lot of poetry, for sure.
Yeah, I got an MFA.
Besides the story of coming to poetry, I love what you said about a teacher taking the time to read the poems and what an impact that had, because poetry is an ear training as much as it is other work.
Absolutely.
What is the story behind the cover art on your book?
Obviously, listeners out there can't see the cover, but I can describe it a little bit. It's really beautiful, first of all. The book cover is white, but the prominent image on the cover is of a watercolor painting of a catfish, or maybe a koi, kind of arcing from the top of the cover down. It's very, very colorful, and it's painted in a Japanese style, sumi-e style. It's also by my mother.
Oh.
Yeah, isn't that cool? And she painted this, and I was over at her house one day, and this was well before the book. I was looking at some of her work, and all of a sudden it just jumped out at me that she had this catfish hanging on a wall. And I said, oh my gosh, that's going to be the cover of my next book. And there it is. Wow. And I just think it's gorgeous.
Did she get to see it as the cover of your book?
She did. Yeah, she's one of my biggest fans. She's 93. She's very well. She's fit. She still drives a car. That's just wonderful. Tickled pink, and she's showing all of her friends.
Of course, it's beautiful.
Yeah, it is. And the back cover is likewise really nice. It's also a painting of a bird on a twig. But in this case, the book designer faded the painting somewhat so that it's much more backgrounded. And the blurbs on the back cover are more prominent, but it's really a beautiful
image. And they're wonderful blurbs.
Yeah.
So we need to read them. That's good. So how did you work with the publisher in getting them to accept your book cover idea?
Lauren Groskopf. I don't know if you're familiar with Pleasure Boat Studio Press. It was originally founded by Jack Estes, who now lives in New York City. He's now retired. And when Jack retired from the press he founded, he handed the reins to Lauren Groskopf, a young woman who lives in West Seattle. She's a mother. She has a grade school-aged child. How she manages to run a press, one can only wonder. She had worked with Jack in the past as a book designer, so she has this background in design, in graphic design. She's now the one-woman band in charge of Pleasure Boat Studio, and we talked over ideas, and she said to me, do you have any suggestions about a cover? If not, I'll find a cover for you. But as it turned out,
you had my mother.
I discovered my mother's painting,
right.
And I said, that's going to be it.
Yeah.
She was very pleased with that.
That's beautiful. Good story. So how about reading us one of the poems from the book?
I'm going to read a poem called Spoon and talk about it just maybe a little bit after I read it, because it's sort of a seminal poem in a way for me. Here we go with Spoon. Thrift store find. 50 cents. I like how stout it is, carved of some uncertain hardwood. One black scar on the handle suggesting its owner snatched it off a hot burner. I like the wear on the tip of the spoon. Someone stirred and stirred, sanding the right side of the bowl to near flatness. The stirrer left-handed, it appears. More than likely a woman, perhaps living, wild surmise, in Iowa in the 30s. Baby balanced on her right hip while she stands in the heat of her Monarch cast-iron stove, stirring porridge or corn mush or mutton stew. Now it's my turn to keep milk from scalding, milk into which I will stir chocolate pudding powder. It's 3 a.m., the 3rd of January. I can't claim to see the light snow that dusts the cars parked out front, since I'm at the stove stirring the pudding. I can, however, see grains fall like salt on the outer sill of the near kitchen window. Just as she, too, might have seen snow or rain fall as she stood and stirred, switching hands when her left grew tired, as my left hand does now. Yes, she was a woman who carved the much-used spoon in my hand, and if not on an Iowa farm, then somewhere else, preparing countless meals, hanging the spoon on its nail through the augered off-center hole in the handle, taking down the spoon, putting it on its nail, taking it down, putting it on, down, on, the years passing, kids having grown and left the farm, removed I'd venture to the city. So the spoon contains all the sadness of her left hand. Even the spoon journeyed away from her, settling against all odds in my kitchen to stir the now just bubbling pudding. It's as if I've entered another life, one where I cook, clean, give birth, raise children, watch snow whiten a stack of cordwood. It's as if she's beside me as I write, as if she has given me the spoon and taken my free hand in hers to stroll the garden of our two worlds.
I'm going to ask you two follow-up questions. First, I'm going to say how much I like the moment of creating the pudding with the spoon, the history of how you got the spoon, your imagined history of the spoon's life with the woman, but also words like uncertain and scar and off-center. There's something going on, right? Yeah. And then it resolves into absorbing this life that you've imagined into yours.
Poet Robert Wrigley has said that one of the things about writing poetry, and I wonder what you think, you're a poet, you get to live twice. You live your life, your day-to-day life, like this interview we're doing, but you also live in your art, inside the worlds that you create when you write. I wasn't terribly conscious of that idea as I was writing the poem, but now looking at it, I see that that's what's going on.
That's
I'm living twice.
Isn't it the best, though,
it
when
is.
The poem delivers and then you are surprised?
Yeah, totally. Yeah.
So you called it seminal. So what did you mean by that?
Well, it's that idea that this represents for me that notion of the double life, of living a second life, one very different than the one they actually have. At the end of the poem, the two lives merge. My life, the writer's life, with the mm-hmm. woman that I've imagined. And we're together. It's like we're almost married. It's that idea of the merging of the inner and outer self, right. you might say.
Yeah, lovely. Yep. I like that. I like inner and outer self. So the law of the unforeseen, mm-hmm. how did you find that title? How do you find titles for books?
If it's okay with you, I'll read the poem and you will hear where the title comes
Great.
From. Can okay. I do that?
Absolutely.
Okay. The poem is called Airborne. Listen for the title. What comes back are 2 seconds of weightlessness. That and a dirt road, purple foxglove in a ditch. The crunch of gravel under the red tractor's great black wheels. There's the grind and smoke of a belabored engine downshifted against the steep downgrade toward a cave of cedars erasing all but scraps of sunlight. There's me propped on his lap, full of the smell of him, Old Spice, pipe tobacco, breast pocketed in his overalls, pipe and pouch pressed against my back, his fat hands on the steering wheel, my small hands tight on it, alive with vibration this fall morning, now startled by the gunfire of backfire, startled again by silence, again by lurch, release, by sudden speed, his quiet hold on, our trailer of firewood careening, whipping side to side, chunks lofted, his foot stomped on the useless brake. There are the 2 beautiful seconds where I'm lifted free from the weight of my childhood, of the fables I'd made, lifted, flung from the jackknifed tractor about to roll, struck in the back by some hard thing, he leaping after me, my face pushed in the muck of the ditch where I flop, entirely awake to the tops of trees, bits of blue, aware that there's no end to it. There's an end to it. I'm not able to breathe or cry or feel thorns of blackberry in my cheek. The sting of nettles in this, the new life, the one in which nothing is sure, everything governed by the immutable law of the unforeseen. I hear the hoarse rasp of his name, see his bloodied head near mine, when he lifts me from the brambles. I'm able then to taste the ditch, spit muck and bits of leaves, able now to understand he threw me to save me, able still to see myself in his arms as he carried me up the hill. Aware of being aware of the light perfume of wild roses crushed where I'd landed, petals matted in my muddied hair.
Wow. Yes, I see the title. I see the meaning of the title. And I also think it's so masterful the way you've described the moment before the brakes giving out.
Yeah.
Where you're full of the smell of him and you list what you smell, uh-huh. and then that little snatch of dialogue, hold on, mm-hmm. which is haunting really by the end of the poem, because in order for you to hold on to life, he has thrown you into the brambles.
Oh, that's lovely. You know, that's one of the cool things about poetry, don't you think, is that readers will often see things that you, the writer, right. may not have seen.
It's as it should be, because if we knew what we were doing, we wouldn't do it right.
Not true. Not true.
Because when you say the law of the unforeseen, every poem is an unforeseen. If we're writing well, mm-hmm. we don't know where it's taking us.
No, we don't. Yeah. We don't. And that's the beauty of it. And you mentioned that earlier, that surprise of saying the things you didn't know you were going to say.
Right. Fabulous. Thank you.
You are listening to KPTZ 91.9 FM, Port Townsend. In case you just joined us, you are listening to In Conversation with Sheila Bender, Discussions on Writing and the Writing Life. Today, Sheila is speaking with Seattle poet Ed Harkness about his latest volume of poetry, The Law of the Unforeseen, as well as about his new work and his start in poetry.
Now we'll move on, because books always take a while to get together and get out there and produced and all of that. And we keep writing, right?
We do.
So I think you're still writing new poetry since this book.
I am.
And I think you might be prepared to read us one of the new ones.
I have, yeah. This one is called Kite, Claylock Beach. Have you ever been to Claylock
Yes.
Beach?
Yes.
A beautiful place on the coast. One of the questions we were talking about is this in any way different from the work that appears, let's say, in the book? It does, and I'll explain that after I read the poem. Kite, Claylock Beach. My job, to hold her kite, the blue one with a snapping yellow tail, the twine taut, tugging like a fair-sized cutthroat. Her job, to sprint around in her underwear on the beach, aglow in late summer light. Come see my jellyfish, Poppy, she yells. Hurry! I lash the twine to a piece of driftwood. There's the jellyfish, a glassy blob at our feet. Will it hurt if I touch it? No, no, it won't hurt if you touch it. Poppy, where's my kite? I turn to see it sail away, a crazed shirt flailing well beyond the breakers full of the sun's late fire. For some minutes we watch the kite become a scrap of tissue in the deepening blue, the yellow tail visible until there's nothing to see but the long blade of the horizon. Waves climb themselves and collapse, clapping the sand. Eternity, I say, more to myself than to her. She gazes up with those sea-green eyes that make me want to weep. I see it coming. She's going to ask, Poppy, what's eternity? And I'm going to say, well, it's like, I don't know, like the sky going on and on forever, like a kite flying over the ocean. What do you think? Is my kite gone? She asks. Yes, I say, it's gone.
I love the poem, but one of my favorite lines is her job. Is to, how did you say it exactly? Is to spin around on the beach.
I'm a kind of a newish grandparent, and this is our granddaughter Cleo, who at that time would have been, I think, 3 or 4, maybe 4. Yeah, this really happened. Yeah. She had this kite, and it got away from me, and I could see.
Oh, because you had to go step on the jelly,
bouncing down the beach and running after it, both of us running, but it sailed out.
I love the description of the waves climbing themselves and how it's a scrap of tissue in the blue sky, and then the blue sky turns out to be how you can explain eternity.
Uh-huh.
Beautiful. Mm-hmm. So tell us a little bit about how this poetry is different in your opinion.
Well, I think it's different mainly because it's the first time I've written a poem about my grandchild. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's like any other poem I've ever written. Of course, you know, you can say that about just about any poem.
Right.
My poems all differ, and they're all kind of unique, and none are quite like others. But, yeah, it's different in that sense. And it's also, I think, partly a meditation on time and that idea that time is going and the reality of knowing that you're on a schedule, you might say.
Right. Especially when you're with grandchildren who are young, with their whole life ahead of
that idea is really at the top of your head a lot.
It's really interesting, although poems might not be alike in your thinking. Uh-huh. We've had one about you as a child with your grandfather.
Yeah, yeah.
And now we have you as the grandfather. Yeah. It's life. And, you know, one of the things I'd like to say that I read, which means a lot to me as a grandmother, is that although the proportion of time that most of our grandchildren know us is small compared to the rest of their life. Uh-huh. But the impact we have on them is very big.
Yeah.
And I love thinking that way.
I love thinking that way too, and you're totally right about it. Yeah. I was really close to my grandparents, so what you say is absolutely true.
Well, I just have chills listening to the poems and could listen to them all day. Before we move on to a poem I've requested that you read towards the end of our time together, are there things that you would like to tell listeners about poetry or a question you wish that I might have asked you?
I would say to listeners out there, there's such great stuff being written. I mean, in our own state, we have just a really long list of wonderful poets, and many of them write books, and those books are out there. They're available.
Do you want to name some of your favorites?
Well, you. Sheila Bender is really a wonderful. I like so many poets, man. Laura Jensen. I don't know if you know her work at all.
She's
a Tacoma poet, yeah. And she was in that Mark Strand class that I mentioned at the University of Washington. That's where I first encountered her. And she was so heads and shoulders above the rest of us poets in that class. It was frightening. She's a wonderful poet. She's still active and still writing. I love Sam Green, former poet laureate. He's got many, many books, and he's the best. He's got another one coming out. I can't think of the name of it. There's a poet in Wenatchee, Derek Sheffield, terrific poet.
How do you spell Sheffield?
Sheffield. He's wonderful, and he has a book called Through the Second Skin, which I've been reading recently, and it's just really striking. How many good poets?
Well, that's a good list, and of course we have poets local to our area. Right here, let alone the whole state of Washington. We have Holly Hughes, who you've been doing some readings with this year.
I've been reading with Holly.
We just can't stop listening.
I know.
But that's a good start. So I just want to repeat the name of your book for listeners, and that is The Law of the Unforeseen. Mm-hmm. It's available from
Pleasure Boat Studio.
Thank you.
Yeah.
It's probably available, orderable in bookstores as well as online.
May well be available in your bookstore.
Yes.
Port Townsend bookstore.
Imprint books, and we can ask for it to be ordered as well.
Yeah, you certainly could.
We have a few more minutes to talk about questions that you might have wished I asked.
Ask me about my next book project.
I am going to ask you right now.
Okay.
Ed, what is your next book project?
Thank you. I've been trying with the idea of doing what poets do at late career kind of book. So I'm thinking of, and it's only in the thinking stage right now, but I was thinking of a new and selected poems book, taking some poems from each of my three full-length collections and maybe a few poems from the chapbooks, along with some new work.
Very nice.
Yeah, so that's been in the back of my mind, and maybe I might get around to actually doing something about that in the fall.
When you said what poets do in late career, I was thinking of Peter Meinke, and he wrote a book called The Shape of Poetry. Oh, it's a very thin book. Yeah. So sometimes what poets do is they kind of write about what it is to write a poem.
Uh-huh.
So put that in the back of your mind.
Thank you.
First do your collected, then
what it is
maybe share with us some of what you know from writing.
Yeah.
So the request I had was you read this fabulous poem, which people can find online at terrain.org.
Mm-hmm.
And you said you wrote it the day that 45 was inaugurated.
It appeared
that day.
I'd written it a little bit before. But
because we had plenty of experience with that very long campaign.
Yeah.
People can also find Tying a Tie and the poem you read, Airborne, at terrain.org, terrain.org. So here we go. And as listeners listen, they'll know just why I've requested this today.
Terrain.org has for a time been featuring what they call Letters to America. So many poets have contributed a poem around that idea of addressing the country, talking in the language of poetry with what's going on now. It's a challenging thing. We live in a difficult time. It goes without saying. For some of us, it's one of the worst times. Shootings almost every week now. So the poem I wrote is Letter to America, Union Creek in Winter. And if there's a minute after I finish it, I want to mention something about the poem. Union Creek is a beautiful creek in eastern Washington. Union Creek in winter. There's no word for it so far. The word for what it means to be in love with you in our sinking world. What it means to hike through new snow. To hear beneath the glass of creek ice the flow of winter percolating its way through the ravine, not quite soundlessly toward lower ground. To join the wild roar of the American River. The word that means we've loved through the avalanches of our time, Loved while the wars raged, paid for with our taxes. Loved while our loved ones voted for hatred. For I want the false past. I want what's coming to me. Protected as they've been by their skin, white as this very snow, draped on hemlocks in the ravine's wavering light. The word that means we're not alone. We share that same nature wonder, for the flicker tapping on a far-off tree, the delicate calligraphy of a mouse's prints along our path, as if Tufu had been here too. Who knew, even then, even in the Tang Dynasty, beauty leaves behind its faint notations. The word that means we will go on. We will follow an earlier trekker's snowshoe trail, slog on bundled to keep the chill from overtaking us, descend again steeply, then climb the switchbacks above the creek away from its cold murmurings to our car and the long drive back to the war zone of now. Armed with our little courage, we must drive straight to the front, strap on flak jackets, and begin the slow search for survivors, slow search for the words that might revive them. Even now we're feverish to make contact, to know what to listen for, to learn to hear those muffled cries from deep in the rubble. If we knew the words, we might save those most weakened, most in danger of giving up. If we knew the words, we might keep the world, its rivers, its ice, its bitterroot, its winter wrens, its hemlocks, its moonlight, its children, its Shakespeare, its Zimborska, its rose hips, its green and orange lichens, its Dylan, its chora players, its hummingbirds, you, me, and our Muslim neighbor, Maya, alive.
What a beautiful, beautiful list of all that's endangered.
Yeah.
Towards the end.
And what I was going to say about the poem, it's a curious thing, and I bet as a poet you've had the same thing happen, where you write the poem and then all you suddenly notice things about the poem that you hadn't seen when you were writing it. This is true here. I did not make up the names of the rivers of the creek, Union Creek. It's a real creek name. And it really does flow into a larger a river called the American River. And only after I was done with the poem did the idea of Union and America suddenly loom large. They become symbolic, but it's strictly accidental. I wasn't thinking
or not. That line.
Well, or not. You know,
yeah,
maybe not.
It's the accidental part of us
that
hears those resonances.
Yeah.
But it didn't go by me, the listener. Quite beautiful.
That wild roar of the American River. We live in a time of wild roars, it seems.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, on that somber note, I want to think back to your very beautiful poetry that you read with us today. And thank you so much for coming.
I'm so delighted. Great to see you again, Sheila.
In Conversation is produced by Sheila Bender and edited by Charlie Fleischman.